Well, I have a number of questions that were generated by some of you, and we'll try to get to those, but first I'd like to just present some things to you. I have a problem. I've told people frequently that I'm probably the best example of the effects of positive reinforcement that you find, because I've been positive reinforced for talking for many years, so I can talk well beyond your ability to listen. If you reinforce me too much for that, then it's your fault that I don't get any questions. But I would like just to start. Let me first have each one of you, if you tell me your name, I won't remember it, but if you tell me where you work, what you're doing, just to give me a kind of feel of the place you're working, so I can maybe target some of my examples.
American Consulting includes a couple of nutrition services.
What kind of therapy organization?
Service organizations, mainly insurance companies.
Sure. Okay. Yeah.
And I work as an independent contractor for the Ministry of Health in Holland to help healthcare organizations in Holland.
Good. I've invested in a startup in Atlanta.
My name is Marcel. I work in an inspection service in the Netherlands for the horticulture. So we guard that the plants which approach the Netherlands and leave the Netherlands are healthy.
Okay.
And I'm responsible for personal communication and quality management.
Okay, good.
My name is Jeroen Kopp. I work for House Performance, and I'm addicted to lean and improve every day.
Lean
manufacturer. Yes. Yeah.
TBS.
Yeah. My name is Emil. I'm managing a program at the energy supplier.
My name is Bart Grotens. I'm a consultant, and I did a big project for Carglass. It's called Belron, I guess, in America. Carglass, Belron. The windshields in cars, repair centers, and I hope to do a lot of other projects in the coming time.
Yeah, okay.
Other companies.
And my name is Willem Vaan. I'm a floor manager in the healthcare, and I go about IT, about software,
IT
new programs. Yes.
Tough job.
My name is Robert. I'm an OBM trainer. Yep. One of the guys trained by Joost and Marius.
Okay.
I have my own company, and I help organizations implement and work with the OBM principles of behavior.
What kind do you work in?
Mainly hospitals and communication organizations.
Okay.
Like telecom
organizations. Yeah, okay.
David Trickles, a consultant. Work for at the moment for an insurance company, and I'm quite specialized in lean in combination with OBM.
Okay.
Lean Kata, things like that.
Okay.
I'm Annette Hartnag. I'm working for the local government, gemeente Alkmaar, and at the moment I'm very busy with refugees. Yes.
Everybody.
Yes.
Yeah, good.
Hi, Judith.
Yep.
Trainer advisor, fertility in health management, self-employed.
Health is popular here.
Hi, I'm Ingrid. I worked 15 years within the primary aluminum smelters.
Yep. Where we
were. We were, yeah. So that's where I learned this OBM. And now I'm working for a fission.
You're waterboarding people. Right?
Waterboarding people, yes.
Yeah, good.
Infrastructure for the ministry, advising by big developments.
Now, are you talking infrastructure, you're talking roads and
roads. Bridges.
Okay.
Perhaps it's good to explain why we use the microphone. The whole session has been taped, and also the audio has been taped. So if you have any questions, just ask the microphone. so we can also take those questions.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I'll do most of the talking early, but later on we won't have a kind of a free roll. Because I know that if you started doing this, questions come up about how do I do this or whatever, and I'd like to answer many of that as I can. But, I mean, obviously you understand something about science, so you know there's a lot to say. I can't really teach you anything about that. But I'd just like to make a couple of comments early. I've seen some questions that you had, but obviously you'll have some more, I hope, as we go. But the thing I would say is that I've come to the point that there are really two skills that I think you need to have. Number one is pinpointing, which is the hardest of all to do. And the other is shaping. But if you shape behavior, then you have to know about reinforcement. But really, kind of, if you kind of boil it down, those are two skills that will help you succeed in most organizations. Now, let me just run over something with you quickly, and that is the five-step process, which I think you've all gone through. Right? Just to refresh. I don't like very good when I'm up front. I don't like very good when I'm out of front. step is pinpoint. Now, we pinpoint two things. What are they?
Results and behavior.
Which way pinpoint first?
Results.
Yeah, okay. We always pinpoint. Do the results first simply because we want the customer to expect an output that's valuable to them. Right? So what are you trying to achieve? And that's usually fairly easy. This is reduced cost or increased productivity or increased quality or shortened cycle time or all those kinds of things. The next thing we're going to do is to pinpoint behaviors, obviously. And that is the thing that's the hardest to do, and in many cases, in the traditional model, it's never done. Now, we do this for many reasons, but one is that we want to make sure that we get results the right way, right? I mean, all kinds of ways to get results, and organizations have learned this. I mean, you can cheat. You know, you can lie, steal, or whatever to get results, and many times, when you look at the results, you never see that, right? But the more important thing is that until you know this, you really don't understand what you're trying to do. Because most managers have been praying for results, right? They want to see some results. And it's been said many times, I heard it in the Army over and over when I was there, you know, I don't care how you do it, just do it. And I was in Korea, thankfully after the war, but we had something there called moonlight requisition. And what that would be is if a commander said, I want X, and I want to hear right here tomorrow morning, you don't ask, how are you going to do this? Because all I want to do is I come in and see that there. And so next morning, somebody would have one and somebody wouldn't. Because you'd steal it from another unit. Or borrow it, or whatever you call it. In many cases, what you do is you go to the village and buy it very cheaply from Mama-san, you know, who had whatever you wanted. And there was a story about when I was there, they had a M49 tank. It was the latest tank in the U.S. Army. Then they had the M47, M49. M49 was the latest one at the time. And so one of the guys goes to Mama-san and says, Mama-san, I need an M49 tank. She says, M49, no, how? M48? But you can buy anything. You know, how much you want for a tank? $100. $1 million piece of equipment. But anyway, you could get results that way, and the Army has a way of doing that. You know, it's kind of interesting. In the Army, in the U.S. Army, it's worse to have more than you're supposed to have than it is to have less. And so we literally would bury equipment. In other words, if we were having an inspection and you had too many of something, you would bury it. Yeah. Or I remember, and I wish we had pictures of this, because we were having an IG inspection, and of course, we were in the mountains all around our camp. And so what we do is all the extra stuff we had, we would have an exercise, you know, climbing up some mountain, and everybody would take the stuff that was extra with them. All the extra stuff with them, and you see the people marching with shovels on their shoulder, and water tanks in their hands, and that kind of thing. But my point is that there are many ways to get this. But generally speaking, we have a set of behaviors that are acceptable. We want you to get them by doing these things. And organizations have processes and so on that they want you to follow to get it. And the only way you can know that is by watching your behavior. You don't tell. Many of you don't know Yogi Berra, the American catcher. Well, Yogi Berra says a lot of things, and I quote, because he claimed, actually, he owned up to all these things because he was famous for his quotes. But one of the things he said one time was that when he overtake managing the Mets organization, he was with the Yankees for years, and the reporter said, Yogi said, how have you... Gone from being a catcher to being a manager. He said, well, I've observed a lot by watching. And I would suggest to you that if you want to observe, watching is a good way to do it. And it's a way that's not done very often. See, most of the time we try to solve a problem in the office. Right? You go in, you know, consulting or whatever, and you sit down with a manager in an office, right? Well, what kind of behavior can you change in an office? What they say about a problem. You can't solve a problem in the office because the only thing that can be changed is what people say. So the thing you need to do in terms of what I've said in your job is the first thing you need to do is say, when somebody brings you a problem, say, can I see that? Can I go out and see what you're talking about? And I promise you, if you do, you will have a different perspective on the problem than if you try to talk to somebody in the office. Because we all put our spin on something, right? In other words, we bring our history to the table, and sometimes we get trapped into language because somebody says something that you're familiar with, and you say, oh, I've got it. I know the answer to that. But then when you go to see, you discover, wait a minute. Is this what you're talking about? Yeah. No, wait a minute. I would not call that what you just said. So see the behavior. Now, what that means, of course, is we have to know behavior. By no behavior, I'm talking about we need to be able to look at what somebody's doing. I can tell you many examples, I won't bore you with them, of how people have had problems for a long time, but they couldn't say exactly what it was. And if you're an expert in behavior, then you can look at something and you can say, well, now here's what he's doing. Is that what you want? Well, no. How did you see that? I give you one example. We were working in a factory that made faucets. And one day the line went down. They had people, you know, working different points on the line, and the line went down. And when it did, there were four people around this table and a section of the assembly line. And when the line went down, one guy promptly folds his arms and goes to sleep, takes a nap. Two of the women, there were four women, there were two women who immediately went to talk to somebody else on another part of the line, because the whole line was down. The woman that was left stayed at her workstation, cleaned it off, and refilled all the little bins with the parts that she had. The supervisor is off trying to figure out what white lines are. Now, he never saw that. And had he been there, I don't think he would have seen it. Now, the guy that was sleeping, I mean, he wanted anything to do as far as he's all right. The women thought it would be a good chance to see their friends and engage in some reinforcement. But the guy, the woman that cleaned up our area, restocked the parts, was ready to go back to work. Now, of course, something should have been done for her, right? At least somebody says, hey, that's neat. That's really neat, thank you. Something simple, you know, but something to note that in fact happened. Now, if you know what you want people to do, then this is easy. But you're going to spend, if you think about trying to solve a problem, I would suggest to you, and I'm making this number up, so just variance on both sides of it, 80% of your time should be spent right here. And should be teaching them how to pinpoint behavior. And the way you're going to do that is by asking a lot of questions. You know, like, well, wait a minute. Now, if they did that, would that satisfy you? You think that would create the result you want? Well, no, not entirely. Then you run into other kinds of things. Now, this is critical, of course, because this is going to drive this. Now, see, most management says we pay you to do this. So do that. That's called management, right? And the typical idea, you know, you got all these benefits, you got this, good wage, and we expect you to do it. And then there's the price when, of course, some people don't do it, and sometimes they do it in ways that we don't like. One of our guys that worked for us had a brother at the Chrysler plant in the United States. And I don't know exactly what his job was, but he had to weld two pieces together, like tie rod ends on a car or something. And he had a certain number to do. And what he would do is he would work very hard the first 2 hours of the day. He would do more than he was supposed to do, and he would hide the rest in a place that only he knew. And he would spend the rest of the day going around bothering other people. Now, he did that for years. And nobody was watching. Nobody was watching. It was basically because they never really cared about what he did. But if we're trying you to do the job, that's what we expect you to do, and so do it. And of course, with unions in the environment, they didn't want him to do more. The concept with the word rate buster, where they would treat you badly if you produce too much. So this man just hid his away, and you know, he had an easy job once a week, because the job could be done in 2 hours. An 8-hour job, he did in 2 hours. So we're going to try this next thing. People. I remember I was in clinical work for a while, and I worked in the state hospital for mentally disturbed. And the first job, one I got the most notoriety was a woman who had agoraphobia. Are you familiar with that term? Agoraphobia is fear of open spaces. Right? So she was basically homebound. She was afraid to go outside, even in her yard by herself. And when I saw her, she had been receiving electroshock treatments. Now you know what that is. Electricity brain. For 26 years. Now think about that a minute. I mean, she'd been going in, you know, weekly or monthly or whatever, on some schedule for 26 years getting electroshock treatments. Now, I often wondered, like, how many years more would he have to do this before he would say to himself, I don't believe this is working. Now, I understand part of where it comes from, because she would get better. As a matter of fact, that's when he stopped giving her, he gave her a series of treatments, and, you know, if he decided he was going to give her 10 treatments over 10 weeks, if she wasn't any better, he'd give her 12. If she was better, he'd stop. And so she'd get better, and then she'd always go back. And she'd be worse. Well, at the time she came, she was not getting out of bed in the morning and would stay in bed all day unless he made her get out. Now, she'd had a problem, she was 52 years old, she'd had a problem with her life. Now, her psychiatrist, as I recall, had diagnosed her as having a desire to return to the womb. And if you read psychoanalytic treatment, you discover that's what the idea is, that they have a desire to retreat to a safe, warm, nurturing environment. Now, if I told you we've got this patient who has a desire to return to the womb, what would be the first thing you'd do? I mean, that makes no sense, right? Now, you see, some of my friends claim that the reason you're a behaviorist is because you're too stupid to be a cognitive person. Now, the difference in cognitive psychology and behaviorism is that in cognitive psychology, you study the mind. In behavior, well, you study. So, you're right, it doesn't make any sense to me. Now, some of my friends will say, well, you're being too liberal. I mean, she wants safety and security. Okay, so what would you do then? I mean, put a lock on her door. I mean, what would you do? Well, see, I was so simple-minded that I thought her problem was she was afraid to go outside by herself. So, the first day, you want to get a baseline, right? So the first day, I take her to the front door of the building, and I said, look, I want you to see how far you can walk down the walkway before you have to turn around and come back. Guess what her baseline was? Zero. She was not even, I tried to get her to open the door, just open the door. Oh, I couldn't do that. Why? Well, I might trip and fall, and the door would shut. I said, well, I'd open and pick you up. No, but I mean, the door might lock. Might lock. Well, I want to lock it, but I mean, it might jam. Well, I'd go around the back. Well, it might be locked too. You know, what I discovered early on, it's impossible to reason with an unreasonable person, right? Of course, that's what phobics have, is an unreasonable fear, right? And so she could justify everything that she was doing in terms of some fear that she might have had. So I don't get deal, but I taught her relaxation because Joseph Wolpe, a South African physician, had a treatment called reciprocal inhibition. Basically says you can't be afraid and relax at the same time. So what you did was you taught the person to relax, and then you gradually exposed them to the stimulus of what it was they're afraid of. And it worked very well. It was we used the Jacobson method, which you used in natural childbirth. It used years ago, this is back in the 30s. They would teach women who are going to have natural childbirth relaxation during birth. And so it starts, you start with the toes and go up to your head. Well, in about, I think, between 4 and 6 weeks, I can't remember, my mind's not as good as it used to be. I'm not even sure it ever was. but I was like, about a month, let's say. She was home. She had a job. She'd never been outside the state of Georgia. She would not even go with somebody further because it's a symptom of a rotten core somewhere. So if you don't get rid of that, then other behavior like this would be. Well, it didn't. And I never had that with it. It never proved to be that way. But Freud theorized that it would, but it never did. Now, the reason I was able to help her, I think, was because I pinpointed the behavior I wanted her to do. What do you want me to do? And see, once you do that, then you've got to measure already. I mean, measurement, we try to make measurement too hard. You know, you've got to measure. I counted, what I did was in the early stages, I counted the number of steps she would take on her own. And then I had her count, then I had her, you know, drive the car and do other kind of things, you know, once she left the hospital. The point was, I could see her progress, she could see her progress. And I said, so you always want, once you've got that behavior, then you want some way, I use measure in the book, but I would say, just track it. How do we track this? How do we know? Now, if it was a desire to return to the womb, I could track it. I could think of some things, but that'd be silly. Problems be practically. But the idea is, how can I know and how can the person know how they're doing? Any of you have a Fitbit? You know what Fitbit is?
Yeah.
It's a step counter. And I have one. I've had one since the beginning. And I have only done 2,584 steps today. Not good. My target is 10,000 a day. I have a friend who we kind of compete in terms of doing over 10,000 a day. One of my other friends sent a cartoon out of a paper. They show two guys in the desert. They're walking through the desert, you know, and they're on their hands and knees, and all of a sudden, one says, 10,000 steps. Well, I guess we can quit now. In the middle of the desert. That's kind of like me. It's motivating to me now to see how I'm doing. And I have an idea how he's doing. We don't really compete because sometimes I'm gone on a trip and I use that as an excuse. But the point is that what we know, you see, that if you provide measurement, then you're able to develop some sort of feedback. Now, I, in what I write, make a difference between feedback and reinforcement. I'm going to give them some feedback. What they mean is, I'm going to try to reinforce it. When I'm talking about feedback, I'm talking about put it on a graph so we can see where we were and where we're going. Where we were, where we are, and where we're going. But for many people, we've grown up with that kind of information. And we've been reinforced for it, you know, in terms of grades and school and so on. You know, we have a way of being reinforced. So you see, the thing about it, if you can put it on a graph, chances are you pinpoint it. Now, we can track results, too, and many times we should. But if somebody says, how did you get that result, you need to be able to tell them that we increase these behaviors with the primary drivers of our result. Now, I can tell you, you probably already experienced this. Most managers don't know that. So you're adding value already. We work with a company that made electrical connectors. And some of them were little pieces, little things. Nothing, you know, this big. And they were the leader in the industry. And their strategy for sales was to talk to the architects. In other words, let's get the architect, because they will be designing things in, and it will be a pull sale if they, if they put our product in there by name. That would increase the chance that we'll get the business. Well, they would fire people without calling architects. Now, you went to the picnic, right? Picnic and office. Well, we did a picnic. What we discovered is that the purchasing agents would punish the salesperson. I mean, we got stories like they'd come in at 1 o'clock appointment. They would wait for 3 or 4 hours. And finally, you'd say, is he going to be able to see me today? So, oh, he went home at 4 o'clock. Through the back door. They couldn't see. And so, what we did was we said, all right, who are your best salespeople? And they told us, you'd always know, right? So they named two people for us, and we went and watched them for a week. They were the best. They were consistently the best performers. How many architects do you think they called? Now, if you did a picnic analysis, you'd know, right? Because it's a punishing thing to do. And people don't just on their own do punishing things, right? They called on zero. Neither one of them had any customer contact, but they were the best. So what they did? Well, they spent their time with the suppliers, the distributors. And what we learned, which I don't know why they didn't know this, was that you could substitute those that called for AMP, and this was T&B, so they would do as good as. In other words, T&B 101 is as good as AMP 30. So they were substituted. So what turned out was the relationship they had with the distributor was the primary thing to sell for the business. And for some many years, they didn't know that. They've been firing people. You see, as long as business was good, it didn't matter. But as soon as time got tight, and all of a sudden they weren't for sales, they began to say, are you calling an architect? Well, not this week. Well, you're fired. Now, I promise you that in your businesses, the things you're talking about, that you'll find that kind of situation. Right? They don't know that. They should know that. You'd think after many years of doing this that they would know that, but in reality they don't. So once you are satisfied with that, and sometimes you pick the wrong behavior, but particularly if you take their lead, you'll be increasing a behavior that's not valuable. And by that I mean it doesn't contribute the result. So that's why I want to track both to see if this is improving and this is not, then it means you've got the wrong behavior, right? So if this is improving and this is improving, then you know, we have an idea that we have something pinpoint. Now, so when I say feedback, now remember I'm talking about a graph. Or visualize. A lot of what you want to do is to visualize the problem for somebody, and not only the problem, but improve. How are we going to make it? Now, this gets us down to the biggest problem in managing, and that is we're going to develop a reinforcement plan. Now, the reinforcement plan obviously is aimed at these two things. We may have some reward that we give people for results, or some reinforcement plan for when I see these behaviors. And you ask others, when you see that behavior, what are you going to do? Well, if they don't know what the devil is, how would they know to do anything? So what you're going to do is you're going to say, what is that? What is the behaviors that we want to look at? So you sit down with them and figure that out after you've gone out and looked, right? And then you say, okay, when you see that behavior, what are you going to do? When you see other behaviors, what are you going to do? So we can look at the other side as well. But generally speaking, what we're trying to do is increase these behaviors. What behaviors you want to increase? Because we know that if they spend their time, 100% of their time, doing these behaviors you pinpointed, then they won't have time to do anything else. Right? So we can solve other problems by just simply increasing the amount of time they spend in productive behaviors. So this is one thing that I think is important to recognize early. That many times a negative behavior need not be addressed directly. Because if you in fact increase the value of the bad behaviors to 100%, then you don't have it. And this is the kind of problem we run into, by the way, in school. That you know, so much of the behavior that children do in school is unreinforced, particularly by the teacher, that they find other ways to amuse themselves. But when you reinforce a child for schoolwork, then the other things they don't have time to do or don't want to do. That's not an interest. And I'll talk about hair and string later. That's an issue. Now, the last thing, of course, is we're going to evaluate. And we're going to go back up here and we're going to look at results. Not only the behaviors, we're going to look at the results and say, have results increased? If they haven't increased, as I said, then we know that reinforcement is not taking place. So we're going to change the reinforcers. If we go back up here and results have not changed, but the behaviors have. We know that wrong way. So if you iterate this model 3 times, that's the magic number. Most people solve that problem in three iterations, but sometimes you solve it the first time. But if you don't do it again, the reason I like this is because it's so practical. I mean, it's diagnostic at any point. And you can teach your supervisor or manager how to do this. You should. So, look at the results, and you look at the behaviors, and it'll tell you what needs to be done next. And people say to me, well, have you been to where it didn't work? I said, no. Have you been anywhere gravity didn't work? I mean, people like talk about culture and all this stuff. They say, well, have you been anywhere in Holland? I said, are you people? Is your heart on the right side? If it is, you have a problem. But we're all the same, right? We're people. So determining whether it works here is this problem. See, we've worked now in close to 40 countries. The only place we have a problem is France. I don't know why the French are so obstinate, but it's like I was talking to a company down there, and one of the guys was about to measure. I said, did we invent this? I said, no. He said, I thought so. If they didn't invent it, he won't hear more about it. You know? But the point is that if it's about people, then we can, in fact, affect. And of course, everything is. As I was talking to one of the groups earlier this morning, is that technologists, people who are developing new technology, don't know this, and they're getting caught short. Some companies are going out of business, and others haven't dramatically shift what they're doing because, in fact, they expect technology to solve the problem. But wait a minute. Somebody's got to use the technology. Somebody's got to use it in the right way, or it won't work. You know, there's a big thing in the United States about we need to innovate fast. Well, some technology will help you with that. And I remember when I was in grad school, just to give you an idea how old I was, we had all the piece of equipment we had was a Freedom calculator. It's Freedom Dutch. Well, anyway, it was the best calculator in the world at that time. It was just a simple desk view. And in doing a correlation, it would go, pum, pum, pum. I mean, it would take you half a day to do a correlation. Now you can do it in less than a minute, right? And so if you have that kind of technology, obviously it speeds up what you can do. But the fact is somebody's got to sit down at the equipment and do it. Somebody's got to input the data. Somebody's got to evaluate the data. And if they do that wrong, then you're going to have a bad outcome. So I'm trying to get a situation with Singularity University, who teaches people about modern technology, and try and get them to understand, to begin to understand that behavior is an important piece. Now, those of you who work with Lean, one of the things we hear all the time, they come to our 1 week class, and they do it. Because they realize that's the missing piece. Matter of fact, one of our guys wrote a book just recently, you have it, Mike.
Sustain Your Gains.
Sustain Your Gains. Six Sigma was the same problem. Same problem with Six Sigma. They would get people to do the first project, and of course there's built-in reinforcement for the first project, right? Because it's new and something exciting, you know, and they're hoping all kinds of things will come up. And then, but the same project, they said, do we have to do another one? And with Sustain Your Gains, you know, you get a new process, and that's reinforcing at the beginning. And then later on, they don't want to do that. We couldn't get people to do that. And what people that come to our class realize is, well, they didn't build enough reinforcement. They didn't build enough feedback, reinforcement, measurement, so, but they have measurement. But they didn't have the other elements to make things work. Right? So I think if you learn this in a fluent, then you're going to be able to solve most problems. particularly this, and this is the critical piece, because this is what's left out most places. Not only are they not able to do that, but they don't understand the importance of reinforcing those behaviors. And they want to wait until, as you understand, if you do the picnic, they want to talk about things that are positive, future, and uncertain, and how that's a waste of time. And if that works, it's going to work only infrequently. I mean, we can't guarantee that that's going to produce a sustainable outcome. And the answer that people have now is about sustainability is, if it's not sustaining, what does that tell you? There's not enough reinforcement for it, right? In other words, if we improve something by changing a behavior, and all of a sudden that behavior goes away, well, we're going to lose the result, right? Well, what's going to make the behavior go away? Either it's going to be punished, or it's going to undergo extinction, right? Whatever. So if we look and see what it is, then we can figure out a way to sustain it. Now, people say, well, will it last? Well, the best example I can give you is Blue Cross Blue Shield of America, where we started over there in 1980. And we're still there. It's not like we go over there every week or something, but they send all of their new supervisors to our training. I mean, as soon as they're made a supervisor, a manager, they go to our training. Because they've designed their culture around the system. They call it PM sound. And if it's not PM sound, they don't do it. And I remember we've had five different presidents. And one of the things, Dick Jones and one of the training managers told me that he was gone for an extended period of time, and when he came back, he found that she had bought some program that he didn't understand, and he thought it was not PM sound, and she said, I thought I was going to lose my job. Because they just don't do stuff that they can't talk about the reinforcement, the pinpoints, and that kind of thing. It's just not the way they do. And so that's lasted 35 years. So we know it'll last 35 years. So for most of you, as I look at you, that would be satisfactory, right? If you can introduce something to a company that lasts 35 years, I mean, then I live you. And so you wouldn't have to worry about it. And of course, they're still going, so maybe 40 or so.
Can I ask you a question about the model you sketched? Can you tell us more about the feedback and reinforcement, because in real life, what I see happen is that people think that they are giving R plus, but they more give feedback,
yep,
or vice versa.
Yep.
And so, can you tell us more about that?
Well, you can give reinforcement without having feedback. And this, if you know what the behavior is, and I see that behavior, and I reinforce it, I can increase it, even though they don't even know about it. I mean, because that's just how we build. If we get a positive consequence, you see, I used an example earlier of small children. You put them down in the middle of the floor. I mean, where are they going to go? Well, they go towards some form of reinforcement, right? Something they can open, something they can pull on, you know, something they can make your life miserable with, your life breaking stuff, but they're going toward stuff that provides them reinforcement. So we could, in fact, work on this without having this. It's harder, because what we want this to do is to tell us to be able to discriminate smaller changes in behavior than we otherwise see. There's casual observations. So we're trying to organize this in some way. The problem is that a lot of people want to use this instead of this, or instead of this. So with feedback, for the performers, we want to give them feedback on the behavior more than the result. Managers are more interested in the result. Of course, if we can get a production group, let's say, that has an outcome goal, a result goal, then we can see improvements in that too. But any way that we can visualize the problem, let's just think of that, probably I'll use the word visualize. If you can visualize progress, then we know that is reinforcing for some people. See, I can guarantee you that if you have a bad behavior that you like change, like you smoke too much or you weigh too much or that kind of thing, a great way to lose weight is to put a graph on your refrigerator. Just weigh every day and put a graph. You'll lose weight, maybe 2 pounds, maybe for about a month. Reduce the number of cigarettes you smoke, you can do that. You can probably reduce them in half for about a month. Because what happens is, you see, if I lose weight and nobody notices, then that's extinction, right? And so after a period of time, I don't pay attention to the feedback. Now, so the criteria that we would want is that, okay, I'm doing this, but it's not changing. So I know something's wrong here somewhere. Either the way I'm delivering reinforcement or that is not working, not valued in the way that I think it would be, but I need to go back and rework this. Now, that reminds me of another point that's very important. Blame is not a part of the system. It's not productive. Blame somebody. And managers want to do that, right? They want to blame somebody. You know, it just makes them feel better if they blame somebody, right? I mean, it does for all of us, I guess. When we worked at Xerox Corporation, they taught me the Xerox salute. And the Xerox salute is this. Not my fault. But not my fault. And a lot of companies kind of have that, right? You want to find who did this. But see, what I want you to think about is, okay, how was the environment designed in such a way that it caused the person to do that? We worked with a company called Dollar General. They have 1,000 stores. And they sell everything for around a dollar. And they've been very successful. And we worked, we didn't work in the stores because they got bought, but we were working in the distribution centers. And Ron, I can't think of his last name, was a distribution center manager in Zanesville, Ohio. They paid low wages. It was a routine environment where basically what you did was you pick stuff and put it online, and at some point somebody put it on a truck. And for that they made about $7 an hour. And that was low then, it's very low now, but it's low then. So we got low wages, routine work, repetitive work, I mean all the negative things you can say about it, they had it. The way you got a job there was somebody on the front line recommended you. Because they never had to advertise for people. They had a very low turnover, number one. But when the job opening came, people wanted it. Now, why would they want it? Well, Ron was the driver of this, as a distribution manager, because what he would do, if they lost a person, if somebody quit or somebody was terminated, which was rare, but if somebody was terminated or lost, Ron got all of his GRA reports together and said, how did we fail that person? Now, usually they think, boy, now he was no count. That's the way we talk about that side. He was no count. You know, he was lazy. He was stupid. Or he was this, that, and the other. He didn't care. He got all kind of reasons. What he wanted to hear was, how did we train them? Did we train them well? When they went to the floor, how fluent were they in the job? When they were on the job, what did we reinforce them? When we recognized it was a problem, what did we do? And so he's always looking at his systems to say, did we do our part? Now this is not to say that at some point they will say, well, he's got a habit. He drinks or whatever, and he doesn't show up, or when he does, he's not sober. I mean, there are those kind of problems, right? And what they were sent to say is, well, we can't help that problem, so we need to help him get you. And you imagine they have a very high performing organization. As a matter of fact, they increased their productivity so much that they were planning to build another distribution center, and they put on that hold. But their performance was so high that they reduced the need for spending $10 million, I forget what it was, on building another center. But Ron looked at it in terms of we design the environment. They don't have a say in that. We design the environment, so if the environment does not produce the kind of behavior we want, then that's our problem. So I would suggest you help your customer look at the environment. Say, what is this environment telling people? You see, what lots of times what you said, that outrageous behavior is sometimes inadvertently reinforced. You know, so we got, I said, how would we have let people know that this kind of thing was okay? And you begin to look in terms of helping them understand consequences, you see that, well, they did something like that a while back. Well, what'd you do? Well, we didn't do anything because it wasn't time then. You know, we got all kind of reason why they didn't respond to it. But when you come back down to analyzing it, it's like, well, what do you think that told them? So, well, we told them if they do it again, we're going to fire them. Well, they did it again. So what did that tell you? To tell them you're going to fire them was a positive reinforcer, right? Positive reinforcer. How about positive reinforcer? Well, it increased behavior. That's what positive reinforcer does. So, I think if you follow this model, teach them to follow this model, then the diagnosis of the problem gets easier, gets real easy. Because you know that failure to improve this behavior is right here. That what we were doing, we thought it was a reinforcer, when it was not. And see, this is the kind of thing that, we were talking about this the other day, that people focus, when you talk about positive reinforcement, they focus on compliments. Compliment is not a reinforcer, most of the time. How do you know you got a reinforcer? And maybe increase it. If it didn't increase, it doesn't matter what you thought about it, right? What is it? What did the person involved think about it? And the only way we know is not what they say, because there may be a negative consequence of saying what they really think. Does the behavior increase? You know, we were working early on in the textile industry, and all these people have really, they had never said a positive word to an employee. They didn't think that was their job. And so we get, many employees are very skeptical of what people said. And so we were in the weave room, and one of our consultants was telling me that this guy, he was a kind of a cranky guy, you know, he was always moaning, you know, and he said, God, well, you improved yesterday. I thought I told you to leave me alone. You don't reinforce me, just leave me alone. Next day, it went up again. So what did he know? I mean, all this stuff, you see, we pay too much attention to verbal behavior. You know, he was in a kind of culture that to respond to positive reinforcement was kind of like, yes, but women do that. Men don't do that. You know. The point was, we thought, well, after a period of time, he would just stand there and grin. He never did talk very much, but he'd just stand there and grin. He cut out the world behavior because it wasn't working, right? From his standpoint, it wasn't working. And he turned out to be, you know, a good supporter of what we did. So we always look back at the data to see if we have this. You see, it's like people say, well, now, are you providing reinforcement? Yeah. What are you doing? Well, I'm telling people to do another job. I say, well, it doesn't appear that that's very reinforcing. Isn't that what I'm supposed to do? Isn't that positive reinforcement? No, there it isn't. You see, here's the thing I think a lot of people don't understand. behavior, no matter what you said, it doesn't make it a reinforcement. You see, if you tell somebody they're doing a good job, what that basically requires is that they care about what you think. As I was talking to a group this morning, if they know, if you have a reputation of saying one thing to somebody's face and something negative to somebody else, and you pat them on the back, do you think it's going to improve their performance? Well, of course not. Because they think you may be just saying that to me. You're trying to trick me. You're trying to motivate me, yeah? Right, well, I'll show you. So that brings up a good point, you see, and I think you as consultants, me, you're consulting, as having that job, your first order of business is to make yourself a reinforcer. To pair yourself with something that's reinforcing. And see, the problem is, when you have this training, many times you go out and you're excited about changing things and you want to get in and change something. Well, the first thing you got to do is sit down with the plant manager or the company president or whatever and say, what is important to you? And don't presuppose that you know that by what you've read in the paper or what other people told you. I mean, it's really amazing. I was in a hospital before I came in to visit out on the West Coast, and this guy had done some things, really innovative things, and we were talking with the head of the hospital, and they had done a token system, you know, where they use tokens and so on to reinforce patients. And they had made huge changes. People had been in the hospital 30 years, and now back out in society. And we talked to the head of the hospital and said, my friend was a psychiatrist, went with me, and he asked the superintendent a question. He said, what do you think is the biggest problem you've got today? He said, getting patients to take the medicine. Now here he had people from all over the world come to see what they'd done on this one unit without a token economy, on the paper program. And he said, we just need to get paper. At the time, I thought, what an idiot. But you see, in my brighter days, what is his reinforcement around? See, medicine. I mean, he thinks giving people medicine is a way to solve a problem, right? And if he can just get people to take the medicine, then a lot of these problems wouldn't exist. So guess what you need to start with? Getting people to take the medicine. That is still a problem today in healthcare. You know this. Those of you in healthcare, you know this. Over half the chronic population does not do what the doctor tells them to do. Over half of them. So we call it non-compliance. That's a huge problem. Cost the United States, it'll cost over $2 trillion this year, 5 chronic diseases. Cost $2 trillion to the healthcare system. It's because people don't do what they're they don't do simple things like take their medicine. So what you want to do is to first find out what are the reinforcements for the person, plant manager, executive, whatever you're working with. I remember years ago, turnover, people quitting. Was a huge problem in the textile industry. And we've been working in a number of plants, and we've been able to show dramatic changes in turnover in like 90 days. And so we're working in this one plant, and I got word that he was not happy with what we were doing. And so I sat down with him and with the consultant, and we showed him the graph of attendance and productivity. Because they had more sales than they could get out there. Because people would come on time, they'd be late, whatever, they wouldn't show up, or they'd quit. So I pulled out a graph of attendance and showed how attendance had gone from the 80s up to the high 90s. And he kind of scoffed at that. And I said, you don't seem impressed with that. He said, no. I said, now we had a time that absenteeism cost like several hundred dollars a day per person. Now it's more. And when I multiplied that number by the number of people that were there, it's a big number. And they said, no, that ain't right. I said, what? I said, what would you say somebody being absent would cost you? He said, $1 a day. Well, if that's what he thinks, then guess what? I'm not really sure I'm a graph of attendance anymore. I mean, obviously there are other problems that he has. You see, if you want to parent yourself with reinforcement, then you know you do something that's going to help him. Working in another mill and another company, and their drivers, they had a fleet of drivers, obviously. And so we had this guy over there one day when the general manager of the distribution operation was sitting down, and Jim started talking with him, and he said, I got a problem. What is it? He said, well, this morning, he said, the last truck didn't leave this yard till 10 minutes after 8. He was supposed to be out here at 7. He said, well, let's see if we can do that. So they worked up a simple chart, which all of you could do. You know, let's track the times and give them feedback on when they get out of the yard. It, as you would imagine, in a week, I mean, it's, well, so what he did, we published this study, by the way, what he did was, the next day, the next week, he was in the cafeteria, and he comes in with a big stack of papers like this, and he laid them in front of Jim, and said, look through these, and he started thumbing through his head. He said, what am I looking for? He said, another project. So, you know, if you get to that point, then you know you can do a lot of things. See, so when Jim began to suggest to him, here's what we need to work on, then if he said yes or no, then he knew how to go. See, but if you don't get that at first, you see, that's your first point of entry, is to sit down with the guy and tell him, what's important here? What are you working on? And don't think you know it. Because it can be bizarre stuff. You see, you want him to be reinforced, and you want to be paired to that. But once you establish yourself as a reinforcer to him, or her, whoever it is, then a lot of things can happen that won't happen if, in fact, he thinks you're fooling with stuff, it doesn't matter. And that got SPC in a lot of trouble early on, because the project, it was almost universal, was to have the team go around and check the temperature in the water cooler. And so the plant managers were left out of all this, right? And they would come in and say, what are they working on? Well, they're trying to get the temperature consistent in the water cooler. What? You see, this is where this is different. You see, that is, we're going to help them run the business. It's not about making people feel good. It's not about making people be happy. They will be happy if they're treated right. But the other goal is, what's the valuable result? Like that. And we're going to help you with it. And so you have to have the confidence going in that we can, in fact, do that. Now, there are a lot of questions about problems that people have that, quite frankly, as I looked at it and thought about it, and I don't know enough about it just to ask the question, that were a result of not being able to look at the result to see, the process to see what we were doing. For example, you say, well, if you use punishment and it didn't work, what do you do? Well, what does that tell you? If you use some punishment and the payment goes the wrong way, what does that tell you? It wasn't punishment. It wasn't punishment. So you either choose another consequence or you take the other strategy. If the behavior's not going up, what's it tell you? There wasn't any reinforcement. See, that's why this is too practical. It's just too easy. I mean, you look at it and say, wait a minute, you know how to reinforce them. How do you know that? Well, the painting is leveled off. Now, I was talking with a group at lunch about this, that if you go to a company and say you're looking for another opportunity to do this, and you say to your customer, I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll guarantee you 20% improvement for the next 5 years, compounded, or I'll give you money. All right, I'll give you zero. How do you think you get them? So here's your problem. You've told me what your problem is. So we're going to improve that by 20% per year, compounded for the next 5 years. You think you can get it? Well, that would be, it would be kind of a linear curve, and what would happen is it looked like this. That's a slight upturn when you're compounded. Now, we refer to that as linear improvement. It's a linear improvement, right? Well, if you read what's going on in technology, what you discover is the technology is increasing. If this is 20%, and this is zero, the technology is increasing like this. And that's called an exponential curve. Some of you may have heard of Moore's Law. That's basically about the power of computers. And that at one point it was doubling every 2 years, then it was every 18 months, now it's less than a year. Doubling in less than a year. And they estimate that in the next 10, 15 years, that computers will be able to outperform the brain. By making like, what is the number? 100 trillion decisions per second? It's phenomenal. What your brain is doing, you see, it's like, you're listening to me, hopefully, but at the same time you're listening to me, you're noticing other things about the room, right? You're noticing that you're here, and the people out there, and that he's got the camera here. I mean, there's a lot of things going on in your brain. You're not able to know all that you're doing. Like you're doing your toe down there, and I mean, you're doing that. Some people say subconsciously, but it's an activity that requires function of the brain. And so what Ray Kurzweil was saying is that there's coming a point, called the singularity, in which computers will outperform us. Mm-hmm. They can think faster than we can. And by the way, the first advance of humans in the work, I mean, of robots in the workplace, is going to be workplace systems, robots as a system. Now, the reason they're going to be assistants is because they don't want to take over too fast. See, I came over here in 747, and honestly, I thought everybody in the lab was going to get on that plane. I mean, people just kept getting on and getting on and getting on and getting on. It's pretty heavy here. There's also big people get on. Can they get this thing off the ground? Well, the thing about it is that they did not need a pilot. Send that thing from that here. So why do they have two pilots? Because you want them there. It's not because technology is not advanced enough to fly that plane. As a matter of fact, it can fly the plane better than the pilots already. And some of the crashes have been caused because the technology was so advanced that the pilots made mistakes. And if they just let the plane correct itself, this is what we're up against. And what we're trying to do is to have our customers think about the future. Because what's happening is this bottom curve, it's kind of flat, again. It takes a long time to gain speed. Notice if you start out with 2, 4, 8, 16, 32. It takes a while for it to be noticed. This happened in America to a lot of companies, but industries, but the automobile industry was one that got caught flat-footed because they saw something happening in Japan that they didn't pay attention to. And all of a sudden, because it exponentially improving, it starts slow and builds fast. So what happens is out here in the fifth year, if this is the fifth year, look at what you're losing. Look what you're doing versus what your competitors do. So you need to begin to talk to them about, is technology, are you up with technology that's going on in your business? Because it's coming. You can't prevent it. And they say, well, we can't afford it. Well, you better afford it. Because if you don't afford it, your customers don't run you out of business. And we see that happening all over the place. There was a venture capital firm that was funded by a venture capitalist in California. $30 million they got in seed money. They're working like 6 months on this product. And it was an IT product, you know, a platform and all this kind of stuff. The week they were getting ready to have an open house to show the investors and others their new product, they went out of business. Because a company in Florida had come out with a product that was vast, superior, and cheap. So it happens all the time. Yeah. Oh, okay. Fine. You do that because that's how many you got in your hand? Is it really fine?
It's really fine, yeah.
Okay. Well, anyway, this is a factor, you see. My point is, increasingly, we don't have time to do this the old way. Blue Cross, I mentioned, we just sold them another thing we do. Because the training department has get a lot of pressure for training people faster and better. So can we train them as good in a shorter period of time? Because our budget is out of control. Maybe some of their jobs require a 6-month training period. Several months on the job and two months in the classroom. And so we gotta present them with a way to train that in a month. 1 month. Whole thing. Can we do it? We're gonna do it. And we're gonna train them to do it. Because we know about fluency. We know how technology can help us accelerate learning. And so when you go in, as you think about all these problems, that the more you know about behavior, then the more you're able to put people on this track. I'm sure you all know about autism, right? Well, autism treatment has advanced so that today, it's my opinion, that if a parent doesn't use behavior analysis in the treatment of a child, it's really negligent. Because it's so effective in working. But the problem in that industry, if you want to call it that, there are many, many, many hundreds of autism centers in the United States now, that they, at the current rate, they can perform miracles with a child. I mean, children that don't speak, children that can't walk, and all these kinds of things, they can do that all the time. But the problem is, there, as I look at it, they're on this line. For several months, a year, what, you know, they can, and the parents are happy because they've been other places and no progress and they spent a lot of money, and now all of a sudden, you know, they see these changes. But the problem is that they are getting reinforced for this result when they could be getting this result. See, as you begin to think about this, if you help a customer be successful, you're changing your behavior. Because that's what you wanted to do. That's reinforcing you, and see that, reinforcing you for what you. So you have to worry about, am I getting reinforced for doing stuff that works, but only to a point? Now, there's one thing that I like about the word accelerate. If you think of positive reinforcement, accelerates the rate of responding. So if you see this line, then I want you to say, wait a minute, we're not doing the job of reinforcement we need to. See, technology is allowing us to do more reinforcement than we could without it. believe I talked about it, we spotted an opera condition. But opera conditioning is like people, I need to know that. Well, it's really pretty simple. Opera conditioning means that your behavior operates on the environment to produce a change, which is reinforcing you. And the way the environment is designed in many ways to produce what it produces, but if I go over that door and try to get out, and I pull on the handle, and I can't get out, what do I do?
Try different ways.
I try again. I pull on it for a while. I'll kick the door or something. All right, find another door. All right, let's say I come to this door, and I pull the handle, and it works. What's happened to me? I've been reinforced because it worked. See, so anything that works for you is reinforcing. It's a pick. So if you can design the environment to produce those, then you've got people's attention and you've got people's behavior in a way that you wouldn't otherwise. So you see, we've got, in most companies, we've got the ability now to let everybody know how they do it. Still, there are many companies, plants, other places, that don't do that. So you wouldn't it wouldn't require as much personal reinforcement if you had that kind of technology as if you don't. Because that could give you instant reinforcement. I can look at this thing at any point in time and know, how many steps I've taken just since I've been here. So nobody has to come and tell me I did that. We did in the old days, right? So technology is really helping us, and I encourage you to think about how you can, understanding how baby change takes place, that you could try to get them to re-engineer the environment to produce reinforcement. It's not going to replace social reinforcement, but it will be an aid. It'll be an aid. Now let me stop here and take a break. Is that the idea?
Yeah.
Okay, we're going to have one.